Hi there, I'm Darren Cox and welcome to the second edition of Match Fishing Live. Excited day for me as well today because we're here at a place called Grimsbury Reservoir. It's a place I've never been to before in my life. It's actually an invitational match and we've been asked to come over and have a go. It's just so close to my house, it's crazy. It's 15-20 minutes away from where I live, almost in the centre of Banbury. But it's quite an exciting venue. From what I've heard about the place, it's full of big bream and big carp. Lots of roach and perch on the pole. But looking at the weather today, it's not the ideal bream day, but you know, you may as well be hung for a sheep as a lamb, so I think we'll be fishing for bream today. It's just a square concrete bowl looking at it. It's quite amazing. I'm looking at the colour, which concerns me a little bit. When you're fishing in bright sunshine, nice wind, but the clarity, the water clarity, oh, it's really, really clear. But we just got to do our best. We've got to put a plan together. We'll talk through the plan in a little bit. What I think we need to do to catch some fish and do well in this competition today. And we'll go for it. We'll have a look. I've got a little plan on the sleeve, actually. I thought, you know, these big fish, day like today, we could go for it. We could put a steady ground bait feeder together, put a little bit of bait in and sit and wait for 5-6 bream. But you know what, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to go for it. I've got the old spawn. I've got the baiting rocket. So we're going to have a go. We're going to put some feed in. One of the difficult points today is we're not allowed to use ground bait. It's owned by Thames Water, so it's obviously a water quality issue. You know, it'll be drinking water in here, so they don't want us to use ground bait. So that in itself actually gives us quite a few problems. Normally you'd be using ground bait to get anything out there, whatever particles you need. So I'm going to go with a slightly different approach today. We're going to be looking at pellets, we're going to be looking at micro pellets, corn, hemp, and I'm going to try and get out a bit. I'm going to see where people go. You know, it's a concrete bowl. Apparently it slopes down and then it goes flat. So as long as we get in the right area and get a little bit further out than anybody else, then I think we've got a good chance here of catching some fish. And it really will be a patience game. If these fish are 4-5 pound a piece, then, you know, 10 bites would be a really good day, I think, today. So we'll get some bait in and have a look.
All the way around that bank.
And because he's supposed to be really good fisherman, Darren Cox.
Who? Who? Is that the last one?
Yes.
Yeah. Oh. That'll be a 10 grand then.
29.
In the end.
29.
It's got to be over there, ain't you? You've got to be in the middle.
I've got to be on that. Most important thing. Bream fishing equals food and drink, so we're ordering our breakfast now.
Right.
Yes, please.
Change your mind.
Go on then.
Could I have a bacon sandwich, please, a red sauce? This
and a bacon sandwich.
And a coffee.
Yeah.
Oh my word, hold on, look, don't complicate me.
Sorry.
So.
Nice. Bit of a dash though, isn't it?
Yeah.
Proper dash. Let's hope we fill it. Right, the plan today is a big fish here, and it's one of those days where I don't think you can keep throwing baiting on top of the heads. It's really clear, like I said earlier, and I think the key is to try and get some baiting, whether there's fish there or not. get some bait in it. I might actually sacrifice a couple of fish early by putting a lot of bait in. But if these fish are moving about and roaming and having a look, you know, especially when there's quite a few anglers on the bank and they're not used to it, I don't think it gets fished by big matches a lot here. So these fish could spook very quickly, very early. And if I can get a bit of bait in, get some bait down on the deck, get the swim settled, if these fish are moving about, there's a good chance if they want to have a peck, then they'll tip the noses down and go down some bait. If they find my bait, my plan is to try and have enough bait there to keep enough fish there long enough to catch enough to win the match. Typical bream fishing. With a bit of luck, we'll go in. We probably won't catch anything to start with the amount of bait I'm putting in. But maybe after 50 minutes, an hour, we might start to get a few indications and the swim will settle. Could easily get three or four fish in a row. And then usual script, fish will back off, clear water, big fish. You know, you hook a big fish in the swim, spook the rest of them, but hopefully there'll be enough bait in the swim as when they back off, they know there's bait then and they'll saunter back in. At some point in the day, I might have to put a bit more bait in, but my plan is not to have to. So what I'm doing, bearing in mind ground bait's not allowed, I'm going to spod out at the start, 4 mils micros, some hemp, and some corn. So plenty of particles, plenty of bits, little micros, hemp, lots of stuff to keep the fish preoccupied on just nosing about and grubbing about. It's concrete bottom, but there's going to be a bit of silt on the bottom. It's been here for a lot of years, this reservoir. So there'll be a little bit silty, and you just want those particles to settle on the bed. The fish will come and grub it up, and hopefully just start to kick a little bit of that silt up, and that'll keep the fish in the swim for longer. The idea of the corn is for visibility, so I want the fish to find my bait as quickly as possible. So a tin of corn, you know, 10 bream, as soon eating a tin of corn, no problem. But with a bit of hemp, a few micros, some 4 mils, just mix it up a little bit. What I'm doing now, it's a mad rush today, so I'm going to put my hemp, my corn, my 4 mil pellets all in together. I've got some micros that I've already pre-done, some 2 mils, so they're ready to go. They can go in my feeder and I can put some in there. I'm just going to let these soak a little bit. So first things first, I'm going to use the juices out of the corn just to soak up into the spod mix. And I've got a mix of pellets. Most of my pellets are coarse pellets. You see they're quite white. They're like just a standard 4 mil. They will soak up quite a bit of that corn juice. And I'm just wanting to get the bait into a situation where it'll just go down. You see there, lovely mix is that. Any unsuspecting bream should settle on that if he wants to go. And what I'll do is I'll add my micros to that in a few minutes. My micros are ready, so I don't want to over-wet anything. Just stir that round a bit. You see there's a lot of juice in there, but the pellet should take up most of that juice. I mean, in a couple of minutes, if there's any excess, I'll just drain it off. Quite easy. Number one priority is a big lad. This is the one we're going to use for spodding out. You can get plenty of bait out very, very quickly. So it means I can get the bait out with a bit of disturbance, but the disturbance is over and done with much quicker than just chucking a feeder in a smaller feeder all the time. I'll show you the spawn we're going to use in a minute. But this is just a carp rod. It's 2.5 pound Tesco of carp rod, 12 foot. This will get bait in so quickly. And then I've got two other rods that I'm going to set up. I've got a standard 12 foot Super G feeder, lovely rod, 12 foot rod. We're not going to go a big distance. I'm going to be fishing with a pellet feeder rather than a standard ground bait feeder. So a pellet feeder, you can chuck them miles with most standard rods, so you don't need to be over gunned on your actual rod that you're fishing with. So that's my 12 foot. And then all my reels that I'm fishing with are loaded with braid. I've got a 10-pound shocker on my spod rod, loaded with the same braid on all my reels. That means I can clip up and I can get everything very, very accurate. The last rod is a 13-foot Super G distance feeder. This is just, I'm just setting this up just in case wind gets up, conditions change. Just means that I've got my options open there. You know, if I spod in at 50 metres and I can't catch anything, then I've got to make a decision. Will the fish eventually come onto it? If I don't think the fish is going to come onto it, then I might have to chuck even further. Just by setting this extra rod up, just gives me that option again to go a little bit further away from my main feed area where there will be a lot of feed. But we'll feel our way into the match, you know, hopefully we'll catch on the ground bait, sorry, not the ground bait, but hopefully we'll catch on the main spod area. But the wind's nice actually. The wind's going away from us, which is not ideal for bream fishing, but there's enough ripple on the water to catch some fish. I'm just seeing if there's any depth change, depending where we're chucking. It's about a count of 7 at 25 metres. Just chucked about 35 metres, again it's a count of 7. I'm going to give it a little bit, a bigger chuck now, and see if there's any change. Count to 7 everywhere after this initial slope. I've got an ounce bomb on, so I would say a count to 7 is going to give me, I would say it's about 13 foot with an ounce bomb, probably goes 2 metres a second, I would say. Head, sorry, 2 feet a second. Yeah, it's very even depth, which means, you know, potentially the fish could come quite short in good conditions. But the wind's over my back, it's going away from me, so what I need to do is be sensible. I'm gonna go a decent distance. I'll look at the distance the guys around me go and work from there. With me putting quite a bit of bait in, I need to find my own space and try not to share any fish. I want a fish to settle on my bait and stay there. Not the conventional feeder box that you normally see for bream fishing, but times are definitely changing. They really are. We, you know, features and things with Alex Bones and I, we've actually proved in DVDs in the past that where big bream are concerned, you need to use things like method feeders, pellet feeders. Today, I'm going to choose fish a pellet feeder. A little bit of depth. When I get my bait down, I'm spreading a lot of bait out with the spod. So, you know, it's falling from the surface and it's going to spread over an area. What I want to do is, when I'm sending my hook bait out, I want it to be precise in an area where there's a nice little nucleus of bait. So those fish will hone in on the larger table, but they'll get in and grub up really where my feed is, where my hook bait is, and that's key to catching them quickly. So, lasticating method feeders, big bream, I think they work very, very well, just like they do with carp. Fairly safe, that's what's all about it. Gonna be using barbless hooks, be using a decent size hook, because I'm gonna be using a boy leaf for starters, so something like a QM1 in size 14, 018 hook lens to start with, and I've got some fluorocarbon hook lens tied up, so I'll probably drop one of those on and we'll have a go. First point of attack is set up 018 to a basically 018 garble line, straight full garble. I'm going to use fluorocarbon to start with, but I'm going to fish a QM1 size 14 to a hair rig band. Then what I can do is I can fish with a pellet on the hook, a 6mm or 8mm. I can pull the band through a boilie, which is probably how I'll start, to be honest. A nice visible bait. But people think, wow, 18 for bream, but you've got to remember these are 4 or 5 pound fish, and the principles of method feeder, pellet feeder fishing are totally different to catching bream as you would when you're fishing the conventional ground bait feeder. You know, with a ground bait feeder, you're fishing with long tails, you're expecting the fish to go up into the hook, pick the hook up, actually take the bait and move away. And they've got too long to understand what's going on if you use as thick a line as you would on a method feeder or a pellet feeder. On a pellet feeder, they're seeing a load of bait and they're grubbing into it, picking up, sucking and blowing, and they're just picking up so you can get away with that thicker hook length. And often, that little bit of rigidity and stiffness in hook length, it helps hook up. Really, really important not to fish too light with method. Right, okay, like I said earlier, we mixed up all the corn, the hemp and the larger pellets. What I've actually done, I've just put my 2 mils in there because they were ready. I didn't want to put them in too early and mush them all up, but we're getting within 10 minutes to start of the match now. So it's all ready to go. You can see it's taking quite a bit of water. Drop a bit in the edge and you'll see it's all going down, it's going down nicely. Beauty about this is when this bait goes down and it goes on the bottom, it stays on the bottom. These fish find it, they'll be down and they'll be feeding on it. None of this kicking ground bait up and particles going too high in the water and getting liners. The setup we've got a proper trap. Lots of bait on the bottom. Method or pellet feeder where the bait's right on the hook bait. So, you know, it's the perfect trap for bream fishing. Let's just hope with the clear water, it's got some ripple, that's the main thing, but let's just hope we get a few wraps. I'm gonna transfer the amount of bait I need initially to spod into here. And this tub takes about 3 pints. So you can see that's about 3 pints there. There's a lot of bait to go out there. And I'm pretty much gonna put most of that in at the start and sit and wait. We're going to have plenty of time once I've put some bait in. I'm spotting quite a bait in for the 5 hours, not for the next 5 minutes after I've fed. So I'm going to try and be as accurate as I can. Take my time with the spod. So I'm actually going to do it the reverse way around that we would normally do. I'm going to wait till everybody else's cast down, see where they're going. And then what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna make my own space. I'm gonna go, I would hope, another 10 meters past where they're going. And that means that any fish that back off all the splashes from the feeders and the bait going in, yes, they're gonna back off where I'm feeding, but my logic is when they start to come back, they'll come to my bait first. Which means that if I've got enough bait down there, then hopefully I'll have a longer catching session. I could catch maybe for 40 minutes or even an hour longer than them. If it's one of those days, the bream might not actually come any further in if they've found some feed. You know, if it's one of those dodgy days, clear skies, pressure going up, you know, there's all sorts of things. So I'm gonna clip up when I chuck my spot out, when I know where I'm gonna actually fish. So what I'll do then is, once I've finished spotting, I'll go to my sticks, my measuring sticks, which we'll show in a minute, and I will measure out how far I've actually cast with my spod rod. And then what I'll do is I'll marry that with my fishing rod. It's only going to take me 2 or 3 minutes once I've done it, but it just means that I can set my match temperament and my distances to how I feel is right, rather than measuring sticks out at home, which is, it's all very good, you know. If you're going to a venue where you know that the fish are at 45 metres, by all means, measure up at home or measure up as soon as you get to your peg with your sticks and it's done. But when the distances are variable, and the distances can be depending on, not on weather, you know, there's times when if the fish are at 60 metres and it's blowing an absolute hooligan, then you might have to make a decision, because if you've got to feed a lot of bait, you might not be able to get that bait out there. So it might be worth fishing 50 metres, fishing within a safe and comfortable distance and being accurate. But, you know, that's my take and that's my theory on it. And, you know, I've found quite a few times it works. We'll see what happens today. 3 minutes to go. Through choice, I'd like to be on that bank. Old Steve Waters, good angler from John in Oxford, he's over on about peg, I think it's about peg 18, peg 18 or 15, which is 2 or 3 pegs off that far end. Wind's batting in there, but there's wind in my peg. So, you know, okay, the fish may be over that way, but I'll go a little bit further, hopefully. Plenty of wind on where I'm intended to fish. So hopefully we'll catch some. Okay. Right, I've put 8 in. This is going to be my last but one. I've gone quite a lot further than anybody else, so I don't think I need to go really silly on bait. I'll have this to myself anyway. So, no ball. We'll do it on again. Right, this is, I've put 8 in, I'm going to put another 2 in. I've gone quite a bit further than anybody else, so I don't think there's a massive need to put loads of bait in, because fish find me out there, they're not going to stay closer in, they're going to stay out there. Right, spudded out. What I'm going to do is I'm going to check on my sticks exactly how far I've fished out, so I can count up how many turns I've gone out there around the sticks, and then I can match that to my rods. So here we go. Count 14. The sticks are 5 metres apart, which gives me 70 metres. So I've got a clip up now with my other rods at a count of 14. Means I can be really accurate then. Takes a little bit of time, but it's well worth it. Which means that if I need to spot out again halfway through the match, everything's ready. Everything's clipped up, dead easy. Know what I'm doing. Just looking around, there's still people feeding with conventional ground bait feeders. Can't see anything being caught, so I've not missed out at the moment. Right, this is the rod I'm going to fish with. So I'm going to clip this up in exactly the same way. Gotta be careful when you're using braid, when you're reeling braid back in, when it's slack line, just keep your eye on the braid as it comes off the pegs. As long as you're sensible and careful, then you shouldn't do any damage to your tips. That's just hear me shock leader there. I've got an 8-pound Technium shock leader on these rods, so I'm not rods that I'm fishing to 09 braid, which is it's a lovely, nice 8-strand braid. It's actually one of our Sakura ones. It's a low fishing one, but really good for this type of work. On my spod rod, I've got a 10-pound shocker with the same braid, so everything should match up. There's very little stretch in 8 to 10-pound line, so once I've clipped up really accurate, just take account of the slight difference in distance. So I've just come about that much shorter with this, just to account for a little bit of stretching in the rod. Okay. Right, first cast. You see the culprit there, look. There's a boilie waiting to catch a nice bream, packed with 2mm pellets. Just gonna cap it very slightly so that we'll get a little bit of fall come off that feeder, but apart from that, should be very little comes off the feed. I can get that down in amongst that loose feed. And then the key then is to just keep my eye on the tip. See, these big bream, with braid, you're going to see indications and liners. So just got to keep our eye on things. sinking the braid. First few casts until the braid's taking time to sit to soak water in, then you'll find that you get, you know, it takes a little bit of time to get down, but once you're in the fishing process, then it's fine. One way you can solve that problem is to just soak it in washing up liquid. I tend to use our G-Sink just to spray that on it once I start fishing, and just keeps it sunken out of the way. It's all sunk now, all sorted, we're in fishing position. I just put a little half decent bow in the line to start with, because a half decent bit of tension in the tip to start with, because what that'll do is that'll just pull that bow back a little bit. Fishing with a pellet feeder or a method feeder, you don't particularly need a soft tip. You know, if I was fishing a conventional feeder, then I'd be looking at using the lightest carbon tip I could get away with, or even a glass tip, just so you can, when that fish picks that bait up, what we were talking about earlier, we're talking about with conventional feeders, you use long hook lengths, lighter lines, smaller hooks, so the fish picks the hook up, takes the bait away. And as the fish takes the bait away, it doesn't want to be feeling any resistance at all on tip, and that's why we use glass tips. Method fishing, pellet feeder fishing, it's totally different. We're fishing a bolt rig, so you can get away with a stiffer tip, but I do like still just to use a slightly softer tip, because what it does, it really highlights the liners. And watching for liners when you're bream fishing is so important. You know, one of the things we do a lot is we use a stopwatch. So just to give you an idea of how long your rig's been in the water. Now sometimes when there's a lot of fish in the peg and you've not been able to spot out, you're very mindful of keeping bait going in the peg to keep fish there. Sometimes these fish want a little bit of bait falling through the water because they follow it down, especially with ground bait. If you can use ground bait, then a ground bait trail falling through the water does attract fish down, especially in clear water. But by timing your casts, keep an eye on your tip, you start to build a pattern up of what the fish are doing, if there's any fish activity. You often find that when you time your casts, if you do have a day where you catch 6, 7, maybe 8 bream, it's incredible how often the bites come at the same time in the cast. You know, so for example, you catch a bream and it comes after 7 minutes. It's incredible. The next fish, or the fish after that, often come at the same time. It must be something to do with the way that the fish react to the feeder going into the water, or potentially the breakdown of the bait on or around the feeder. But when you find a pattern, you then start to save time, because there's no point fishing into 15, 20 minutes, which you can often do with bream fishing. If your bites are coming regularly at 7 minutes, you're better off winding you back in and having another chuck, because then you know that there's a little bit of bait going through the water, that attraction's there. It's 5 hours bream fishing can be a long day, but you really have got to concentrate. It's not a case of sitting with your legs crossed and just watching the world go by. Keep your eye on that tip and you will see and learn so much more about what's going on under the water. We're 34 minutes in, I'm 16 minutes on the first cast. So I've purposely left this in for a long time. First reason, I haven't had a bite yet, but I didn't expect one. The way I've fed, I'm expecting a long wait for bites. But nobody's getting bites on the lake at all. The wind's turning round very slightly. This morning it was going over my back, over my head. Still with ripple on the water, it's not a problem. But now it's just starting to turn that way a little bit and go down towards the yacht club. So hopefully we'll get a few pulls. But it's a patience game. This is only what I expect. I didn't expect to get a bite, and that's why I've left it in for a long time. I'm just trying to get the swim to settle. If I was fishing a team match or something like that, I would have set a pole up, and I'd probably have put some baiting on the pole and been, catching some fish now, just roach, perch, just to really let my swim settle. But, because it's a nice match and it's one of those places where you've got to catch You've got to catch bream to win, really, I would suggest, unless it's a completely bad day. I would imagine there'll be some people catch 5-6 bream, even if it's a hard day. But you, when the 6-pound piece, you're not going to beat that with small roach. So we just be patient, just keep our eye on what's going on around us, keep our eye on the clock. I'll be ready for another cast probably in about 5 minutes. It'll be a 20-minute cast, and that's plenty long enough. Just had a proper jab, which looked to me like a, you know, some fishing braid, so everything's exaggerated, but it looked like, oh, I've just had another indication there as well. That's good news. It means that there could be roach. There's some big roach in here, and I know they catch big roach even on boilies. But that's a great sign. There's a little bit of activity, some fish there. I don't mind there being roach there, because that activity from those roach, you know, they're not going to eat all my corn and my pellets. That activity should help encourage a few other fish to feed. What we need is a bit more cloud, and I think we'll definitely catch some fish. But good sign. Lovely. Oh, is that all for me? Perfect. What are you guys having? The guy on the other bank, just seen him get a fish. It was a small fish, a roach or something like that. So, good sign. But an even better sign is the guy two to my right looks like he's got a fish on there, and that looks like it's a bream to me, or a good fish. So there's a few fish feeding. Now, he's definitely not put as much bait in as me, so if it's a day where we need 2-3 bream, he's going to beat me. If it's a day where we need 10, then I'm still hopeful. One thing to be mindful of, obviously, the way I've fed, I've spotted bait. So as the spod hits the water, it opens up. So I'm feeding, loose feeding particles from the surface. It's about 14, 15 foot deep out there where I'm fishing. So I need to make sure I get my angles right. If there's some tow, and the bait's going in slightly down toe, then my marker, where my spod marker was, I might actually have to fish 1 metre, 2 metres, or 3 metres further down toe. And one of the good ways of doing that is when you pick up your rod the first few casts, just have a look at the way your braid's going. You know, obviously, if there's a lot of tow, your tip will bend round and stay bent round. But what's braid is good at, it's good, it helps you pick up that bow, and you can see exactly how hard the tow is. So if there's a big bow in the line, then I might be tempted just to move a metre further down. You know, that spotted bait is going in a nice area, and like we said, we want to try and keep it tight, but you need to search around on that spotted area to find where the bream are in the first three or four casts. And then when you start to find a few bites, then you can focus on it exactly where you are. So it's really important, you know, if you are moving downstream, down toe slightly, just keep your eye on your next chuck where your marker is. You know, your original marker is, for example, my marker is, I've got an angler and a board and a life buoy, and there's just like a metre and a half area that I've fed that spot in there. So if I move down my peg slightly, I'll just go maybe another meter and just check exactly where I am and make a mental note. Just checking that if there was any bow in the line, any tow on the water there. My braid came pretty much straight up there, so there's not a massive amount of tow, which makes sense because the wind is largely over my back. But just good to know that I'm casting on top of my feed. When my feed landed on the surface, it's likely that my feed has dropped down, straight down, rather than traversed along a little bit. This has got to be one of the most sociable events I've ever been to. You get a bacon egg sandwich delivered to your peg. Perfect. Right. Well, third chuck in, and just shortening my casts a little bit in terms of time. Tried a red boily start, white boily, then a red boily now. Right on the money that was. Hopefully we'll get some liners this time. The wind's just dropping a little bit, wasn't it? We've got cloud cover now, which is great, but we need this wind to keep whipping the water up. The last thing we want is a flat, calm mirror lake. Not good for bream. We're 1 hour and 20 minutes in now, and chap two to my right, he's had three in three chucks, which is standard bream fish. It's what you can expect from bream. You know, you get little pods of them come in, they have a proper go at the food, and then they get spooked, you know. It's very regular when bream are moving about that you get those three quickly, and then they're gone, and you think they're gone forever, but they do come back. And if I was sat on his peg, I'd be more than comfortable thinking, oh, they'll be back in 25 minutes, half an hour. But I'm sat on this peg, and I'm hoping that he spooked them, and they come this way, and they're going to settle on my bait. Yeah. This fish are definitely moving. They could be passing through. The guy to my left just hooked one, and I've just had an indication. So there's definitely some fish moving about, which is great news. Let's just try and get them to move onto the feed now. How looked? There's some fish there now. I've just gone in last chuck, and the tip's gone. It's gone round and stayed round. I picked it up, there's nothing there. It's obviously a liner, but it looked like a bite. And I've just gone straight back out, and the tip already, I've had two or three indications in a minute. So there's obviously some fish on the feed. Signs straight away. Hopefully they're not roach. Tips, there's a fish there, and the tip's moving about. I'm crossing my hands to try and keep them away from the rod. I just don't want to pick up unless there's a fish on now, because I know there's fish there. And the only time I can afford to spook these fish is when I've actually got one on the hook. That's the price you have to pay. Grab another chuck. That was a 15 minute cast. I've had a few indications and then nothing. Oh, apart from that one. Maybe I'm going to leave it a few more minutes. It just went. Eek. We're on. We've got a bite, got a fish. Got a fish at last. But feels like it's a bream. Where he's playing. There's just too many indications not to get a fish. A big fish. Got to be very, very careful with them, especially using braid. You're very direct. The rod's quite soft, which is nice. Got a little bit of elastic in the feeder, so as long as I just take my time, bring them in, and then when we get to the rod tip, the netting position, just be very, very careful. We'll bring them to the top to the net. That's a great sign, because I was getting lots of indications all the time. And I was convinced that there were fish on my feed. I've put a lot of feed in. So it was taking me a long time for fish to find my feed with the amount of feed I put in. but hopefully, if there's a lot of fish come on it now, we should get a nice repeat process in a minute when we go back out there. Just take my time a little bit here. Yeah, it's a nice fish. Lovely fish. That was your first fish, you really want to take your time. Things with bream as well, you notice I'm using a long handle. And you want to try and net them where they come up. Because I'm using a 12-foot rod. And it's just here, I'm just want to take my time. There he is. Yeah, that's a nice fish. First one in the net. Always nice. First one and a big old fish here, isn't he? Nice fish. Put him in the net and let's hope he's the first one of several. What I tend to use for a lot of my feeder fishing is a G-sink. This is not a very good example because it's been kept in my bag for a long time. You don't get too much of it. But just what I tend to do is just spray a bit on my reel, on the spool, just literally. And when you reel in, once you've got actually reel right in, spray some on there and it just helps the line sink through the surface tension of the water. I'm getting signs again now. Got another good fish on here. That's two fish in two puts if I get this in. Well, that's great news. And get three in three puts and then let them regroup and then another three 20 minutes later, then the build is on, then the peg's just slowly building up, which is what we wanted. We've got a lot of bait in there, as we know, but these big lads can eat some bait fairly quickly, that's for sure. The big old fish. But that's what's interesting, is I got a bite, like a liner or an indication straight away within a minute of the feeder going in, and then nothing. I waited 7 minutes longer and it's gone round, just, and it's just banged and dropped back. I had a lovely drop back, I could tell the fish was on. Self-hooking, it's perfect. Proper big old nodding fish these are. Beautiful style of fishing when you're catching bream. There's nothing better. Because you wait for so long to get bites and you've got to be so patient. When you actually get one, it's so rewarding. I know there's a lot of instant gratification with carp fishing these days, and we all love commercial carp fishing. I love it as much as anybody, but there's just something special about when you're fishing these big open waters and fishing for these great big bream. Beautiful fish. It's close to a net now. Oh, he's a big lad. He's bigger than the other one. Another one straight in the centre of the bottom lip. I'm just going to show you that before I hook it. Look at that, that's right in his bottom lip. You see, that's nice, that means that they're upending, They're feeding really, really confidently on the bottom. They're grubbing around looking for bait. It's a perfect way to hook a big fish like this on this kind of rig, because all it does is it, as it picks the bait up off the bottom. It's only got 4-inch gait, picks it up and bang, fills it in the bottom lip. And generally, if they're in the bottom lip, they tend to stay in the bottom lip till they come into the net. So we're back in the running now. I've heard the most caught is 4. So we've still got a way to go, but we're in the race now. Just gotta keep that accuracy going. That was on the money again, perfect. See that, straight away. Took that out of my hand, he did then, eh? That was incredible, that. I've just chucked out 20 seconds, under 20 seconds, that was in the water. I had my rod tip under the water, sinking the braid, and I felt that take it on my finger, bang, bang, bang on my finger. That's brilliant news, that is. Absolutely brilliant news. Just try and keep him coming. This one doesn't feel as big as the last one, but it might be deceiving me. When you get to the net, I'll soon know. But they're all nice fish, every single one of them. Just felt the shocker there just coming to the rings. So I know now that fish is close to being netted. Two winds with the shocker in the rod, and that's about the right distance for me to start to bring the fish up to the net. Oh, it's come off, can't believe it. Oh. Oh. No, that was 3 and 3 chucks, that. Oh. I was saying about them being in the bottom lip. It's because it took it on the drop, innit? No, at least I lost it in the net.
Nice.
Absolutely gutted I've lost that fish. That would have been 3 and 3 puts, which is, you know, it's perfect style of bream fishing. The trouble is, you know, you're talking about, you lose one fish, you're talking about 5 pounds. That's a big weight in a match like this. And when bites are hard to come by. But like I say, I hooked it, the feeder had hit the bottom and it had settled, and the line, I was just sinking the line, and the fish must have just followed it straight down. But one of the problems with it, I jabbing at it and following it down, it's probably hooked it in the top lip or on the side, or just not hooked it properly. Really unusual to lose big fish like that on a method or a pellet feeder, because normally they're well hooked. I could have just done with that being another 30 seconds when the rig was all settled up, and I could have seen the bite properly rather than it trying to pull it out of my hand. But you know, you get a proper bite, you've got to lift into it. Not a lot you can do. Oh, I tell you, I'm so relieved now. That's been in 4 minutes since I lost that fish. It's always so important to get that next fish after you've lost one. I mean, the one I lost was at the net, so I would hope it wouldn't affect the swim at all, but you always worry. But that, you know, that's a good sign. 4 minutes in and fish are there. So I'm hoping that these fish have just settled on all that food I've put in now. I've got a decent size pellet feeder on, which is feeding those fish. Every time I get a bite now, there's a little parcel of pellets left there, which should hopefully be enough to just keep that top up. And you know, there's all that hemp in there, there's bits of corn, so lots of visibility with corn. There's a lot of small particle hemp. Big bream love hemp, despite what anybody believes, they absolutely love hemp. and it just makes them grub about on the bottom. They just when they know there's feed there, as long as they're comfortable and feel safe, they'll just sit over it and grub about. And just taking my time a bit with this one again. I'm a bit cautious after losing one. You know, you tend to just try and gather your ranks and just say, right, slow down. But I don't think it was my fault I lost that other fish a moment ago. I wasn't even pulling it hard. The shocker was in the rod, and it was just starting to come up to be netted. Not far now, he's nearly there. That was a drop back again. Same one, I've got a dink. As if it, you know, if it was a small fish dink, but that was obviously the fish hooking itself on the feeder. Then obviously you get a drop back. You often get drop backs on places like this, especially with bream, because they tend to pick the feeder up once they felt the bump. Rather than bolting off like a carp would bolt off and give you a massive bite. It's slightly different with a bream because they're more plod about than anything. Right, time to think about bringing him up. I've just seen a bit of a vortex under the water there. I've not seen the fish yet, but obviously close. Feels a big fish, this does. There must be some big fish in this place. There he is. Oh. Can't bully him, too big to bully.
Oh, he's a big fish.
You don't need to bully fish when you're catching them that big.
I mean, look at the side of that, it's a beautiful fish. There you go, briefly hold him up for the camera. Look at that. Look at that, absolutely beautiful fish. Let's see.
Let me get him in the net and get back out. I want to catch another one now. Whilst they're there, the chances are you've got to make the most of it when the fish are there. You just don't know when they're going to disappear. I'm hoping that they'll sit on my feed now. That's three. Should have been four maybe, but I'll settle for three at the moment. Keeps me in the race. Well, it's teeing up quite well for me now. I'm getting a little bit excited. I'm back in the race. Bloke down there has just got his third on the end peg. There's fish moving about and a bit of cloud cover. I've had four fish on in four chucks. So two in the net, lost one, caught another one. And I've just chucked out and I've just had another liner. So there's some fish about. And that's all I can ask for. They seem to be moving a little bit, which is great, because when they're moving, bream fishing, you feel like you've got half a chance of getting a run of them. So I've had my first run. Let's hope we can get another one this chuck. What I'm quite confident about is I still feel, you know, the big old fish, I still feel like I've got some bait out there for them. I don't feel like they've, you know, if I'd have just put six feeder fulls in, I'd be sat there now thinking, I've got three fish in that lost one. How many other fish are there out there, and how much bait is there left from a group of big fish like that come and mop it up? But I do feel as if I've put enough bait in. You know, I put about 2¾ pints of bait in at the start, which is a nice amount of bait. So as long as I keep getting a few indications, a few fish, I won't do anything different. What is interesting is, you know, oh, there you go, another one. Look at that, 4 minutes. This is perfect. This is actually really nice fishing now. I'm loving this. I'm loving it. I'm not going to say, don't you love it when a plan comes together yet, but I'm feeling like I'm part of the race now. You can't have a go, Joe, can you? Yeah, Jules, I know the match finished at 2 o'clock, but yeah, I know it's 7 o'clock, but Joe wanted to go. Alex went home at 12 because he said it was a wrap. Joe's still here. He's got two rods in. This fish feels a little bit smaller. Still a bream, but I could be wrong, but it feels like it's either coming in very kindly for me or it's a little bit smaller. The last fish I had must have been comfortably 6 pound. Oh, the guy next to me's got one as well. He might have just got a bit bigger, this one. Chap who's got four over there, I think he's just hooked another one. Looking at it. Maybe not, no. Maybe it's small fish because it's coming in very quickly. Getting close now. Right, heard my shocker there, so that tells me I can think about moving the landing net into position. So a long net's really important, a long handle's really important. There we go, there's another one, that's four. Yeah, that chap down there, I've just seen him, he netted that fish very quickly. It looked like a skimmer or a much smaller bream, but he's still ahead looking at it. Oh, that's a nicely hooked fish, is that? Perfectly hooked. Every egg a bird. That's what they used to say at Earlswood. Every egg a bird. Actually, I just realised that I had that miscast, that chuck before that. 4 minutes, I got a bite. And if I hadn't have reeled it in, been vigilant, and cast it in the right spot, I could still be sat there now without a fish on. And that's what's important, is fishing so much, especially match fishing. I mean, if you pleasure fishing, you make a mistake, it's not an issue. If you're match fishing, it can be the difference between winning and coming 15th, because the class of angler is so good these days. And I always say, you know, if you have a gut feeling that you should do something, it's your angling ability, it's your angling instinct that you've nurtured and learned over all those years that's telling you to do it. So if you've got an inkling that you should do something, now do it. Makes you a better angler. If it doesn't work, it just eliminates what you've thought about, and it makes your thought process much clearer and cleaner moving on for that actual match, and also for future. Right, we've got four in the net now. Things are looking up. Exactly half of the match gone. And I think a good target today, looking at the way it's going, I think if you've got 10 bream in your net come the end of the day, I think you'll be there or thereabouts. That should be him. Can't see if this... Oh, this is my biggest fish. This is... Oh! That is a big fish. That is a very big fish. That is a very big fish. We need a disgorger for him. Just inside on the bottom lip. And that is a proper big old lad. Look at that. Twenty past 12. I've just hooked what potentially is my seventh bream. It's I've got to say, it's going very well. It's not manic, but these fish are big and you don't have to catch many. Caught that one after 2 minutes of my last chuck, and I had a fish last chuck. So the way bream fishing goes, I would like to think I should get another one next chuck, which will give me a trio of fish in three goes. And then they might back off again and regroup. But the beauty, as I said, is I still feel confident that there's some bait left there. If I'd have just been fishing a conventional feeder, I'm convinced that I wouldn't have had enough baiting to keep coming back. Taking my time again with every single fish. The match is fairly quiet. The guy in the end's doing well. He's got five fish, I think. All good fish. And the guy on the other bank next to him on the end has got maybe four or five fish at least. But just keep plodding away, fishing my own match. My target is 10 bream, and anything else is a bonus. Like I said earlier, if I can finish up with 10 bream, then I'm not going to be far off. And we're going the right way. I'm convinced this cloud cover's helping a bit. It's not bright sunshine all the time now. We're getting some nice little overcast bits, which should hopefully get the fish moving, get them looking for a little bit of bait. It's just past middle of the day now, so it's not a good time to fish for bream, but that's what we're faced with it being a match. And you've got to make the most of it. I mean, this place is terrific. I would imagine if you fish later on, late into the afternoon, towards the early evening, you'd have some amazing matches. Another nice fish. Got some power. The stand up, I need to be able to see these because I'm trying to net them under the water slightly. It's much easier if I can. But,
There we go. Stand up. Just trying to get him to turn the right way so I can bring him around, but at the moment he's just kite. Here we go. Here we go. Should be alright now. There we go. That's it. He's in the pen. Number 7. A big old warrior. In the bottom lip, just the same again. Another one. Off you go, punk. For you, hook baits with pellet feed or method feed, I firmly believe because you're delivering small particles, that you want a highly visible bait. For me, you can't beat boilies for this type of fish, especially fish this size. If you're fishing for smaller fish, then think about using smaller hook baits. But where the small fish are a nuisance and you're fishing for big fish, you cannot beat boilies. For me, this is the type of boilie I use, 6mm, the Bag'em. High-vis ones, there's no real flavour to them, but I think it's all about colour. You get the flavour out of the pellets that you're feeding. Red and white are my two favourite colours. Today, white I've tried, but didn't catch on it, but that was early. I've got my confidence in the red ones. I've caught all my fish on red, and in all honesty, that's what I keep putting on the hook because it keeps going round, so why change it? If it's, you know, it's not broken, don't fix it. But if I wasn't getting bites, I'd all the time be trying a fluoro orange, a fluoro red or a white, and just trying to mix it up a little bit. But these are great because you can literally put them on a bait spike. Like I was showing before, you just got a QM1 with a little tiny mini band. Pull the band out tight so you're stretching it and just slide that over. And what happens then? Is the boilie sits perfectly on the hook. And you notice my hair's quite long. Say I'm fishing for big fish, so I use a slightly longer hair. I think it's a bit more effective for big fish, big bream and for the decent sized carp. Again, smaller the fish, the shorter I'll go down on the hair. Well, I'd, the 7th fish I had, I had a 7-minute cast after that with a few signs, but didn't feel like I was going to get a bite. I feel like I needed to recast it. I don't know why, but sometimes you get that feeling. And, you know, my killing time was up on the stopwatch. I just chucked it out, and it's gone again. The stopwatch is saying 6.5 minutes now. I've been playing this for a minute. So around the 5-minute time again. It's definitely the right time, 3.5. To 6 minutes. That's when you get a bite, if you get a bite at all. And now what I'm doing is, if I don't get a bite in that time, I'm recasting. I think I need to keep putting that feed in now. These fish fight hard, but the heavy fish. Oh, I just seen the net, that's him. Oh, and kill. Beautiful fish, really healthy fish.
really slimy. You can tell. Absolute fantastic fish these are.
Let's have him in the net, see if we can get another one. Fish number 8, we're on our way to target 10.
Well, I'm really, really pleased with the way this is going. It's not easy, it's hard work, patience, belief, but at the moment it's working. If I only catch what I've caught now and don't win the match, I'll be pleased. It's just, I'll be delighted to do well in the match, but it's just nice when things work and you have a theory about something. It was a very brave thing to do, I thought, this morning, to put that much bait in with such a bright sunny day, but I don't think these fish see lots and lots of bait and lots of anglers, and so just fishing that little bit further out than everybody else and putting that little bit more bait in just means I can just be sensible and patient. Just into the last hour, 2 minutes into the last hour now, I've got 8 fish in the net and I've lost one. I think it's just gone quiet. I've had the last but one cast, I had an indication but not a fish. Last cast, I've not had an indication at all. I just think it's time of day. We're fishing 10 till 2. It's 2-3 minutes past 1 now, and I think it's bright, hot sunshine, hottest part of the day. I think, I might be wrong, but I think that might be the end of the match. I may just be lucky and catch another one or two. If I get another one, the chances are I'll get another one straight after it and maybe a third one after that. But I've got 8 fish, on a bright sunny day like this. Sounds like I'm in the running. We don't know exactly what we've caught over there, but I'm beating these guys on this side. I think I'm beating that guy who's catching over there. So, give me 2 more fish, that'd be fantastic. Just a bit more regular casting I'm doing now, just trying to make a little bit of noise. The fish are obviously not as interested in the bait, or they've eaten it all. They could have actually eaten it all, these huge big fish. Too late to spod any more in now, because spodding that much in is you're setting a trap for an hour or two, which is exactly what happened this morning. So I've just got to be patient, and I've got to feel like if I catch another 2, then I've achieved my goal. Another one, great, but as long as I stay ahead, then that's the best thing I can do. Toying with the idea of maybe just like unclipping, taking 2 metres off my clip, clipping up and casting that a little bit further now, just in case, the fish just backed off away from the made food area. I've had quite a few fish over that area now. And I'm just gonna keep my eye on it. I've got 50 minutes left. The guy on the end has just had another fish, which gives me a bit of hope, because it means that there are some fish still feeding, and there might just be some fish come back into my peg and catch one or two. But I'm gonna give it 15 minutes, and if I don't get any signs, I'm gonna unclip and chuck that a little bit further. Just means that when the fish are not interested in a little bait, sometimes they just drift away. They might only be a few metres away. I've got 35 minutes to go. It's really, really quieting down now. All the anglers that were catching fish seem to have switched off. The only person that's had a fish lately is the chap on the end. I think he's probably got 6 or maybe 7. I'm still on 8, but people who walk in the bank reckon that 8 is probably best or equal best, so we're in the race, but I could really do with another fish. Really do with it, and I don't see any way that I can force it. I've not unclipped and gone a bit further yet, but I may just do that. I'm just gonna see how this cast goes. I am getting the very odd indication. It could be roach, could be lines of fish short on the feed. But at this late stage, I don't really want to be doing anything drastic, because I could get 2 fish in 2 chucks instantly like that. and that's what can win the match. So by if I was in a position whereby I was trying to catch up, then I might force myself to do it. I might force myself to do something to get those extra couple of fish. But whilst nobody else is catching at the moment, I don't think I need to do it. So keep me on the tip, see how we get on for the next 5 or 6 minutes, and we'll go from there. 20 minutes left, 20 minutes. Really slowed down now. The guy on the end peg has just had another one, so I reckon he's got either one less or the same as me. I really need a bite now, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to bring this in. I'm going to chuck it slightly to the left. I've been focusing more right on in front of me, and I know that my spod mix went slightly to the left as well, so I'm just going to drop my bait, my feeder, just slightly to the left this chuck, and see if we can get any more signs or any fish there. In desperation, I've actually put some goo in my pellets. Just a little bit of yellow goo, a little bit of a pineapple flavour. Not had many indications at all recently. So I've just put it in, chucked out, and I've had what I thought was a proper pull round, picked up, there's nothing on there. So either there's some fish moving again in me swim, or there's just one passing through. I'm just hoping that little bit of smell, like different colour, has just activated the fish into feeding again. You know, I'm not one of these people that uses a lot of additives, but I think that sometimes in the day, especially in winter and spring, and times when you're trying to make fish feed, I think they do work. So this is my last chuck, I think. Unless I get a fish in the next minute, this is my last chuck. So we've got to try and make this one count. I think there's two of us on 8 bream at the moment, so it'll be down to fish size, and see how we get on. So fingers crossed this goes again. We've got 8 minutes. Well, that's it. Really disappointing the last hour and 10 minutes, not had a fish, but nobody else has really had any. The chap two to my left on the end peg has probably, in that time, he's had 2 or 3 fish. So he's the worry. He's the one that could have a big weight. I think the chap who was on the end peg over there has had a few fish early and then not caught. I might just rue the fact. I think I should have maybe just dropped 1 or 2 extra spoms in with about an hour and 40 minutes to go. But the problem is I was leading, and I didn't want to do anything to wreck what was happening at that time. But in hindsight, if I could fish this match again, I would definitely put at least one spom in over the top, just to get all that particles falling through the water, spreading a little bit of bait down. So even if there's only 2 or 3 fish left there, then they could be grazing on it. But I've done my best, and I've caught some fish, and I'm absolutely delighted with the way it's gone. Just see what they're weighing now. This is a danger man. He's caught late. He has some proper big slabs. Look at them, beautiful fish. I think he's got 7 there. Some proper fish there. 37.
Nearly.
38.
Any advance?
38.
Yeah, I think.
Yeah.
38.
Well, what a fantastic day. Absolutely beautiful day. 8 lovely bream for a total weight of 44 pounds 12 ounces, and what looks like potential, certainly a framing the match, but hopefully a win. Beautiful fish. Absolutely beautiful fish. What a fantastic day's fishing.
So for first prize at £125, which was sponsored by J.M. Humphrey's Funeral Directors, You should all know about them. The winner was Darren Cox. His catch weight was 44 pound 12 ounces, peg number 29, which was sponsored by Maurice Humphreys, who happens to own J.M. Humphreys Funeral Directors. So, Darren, congratulations. Well done.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Well done.
Thank you.
And, thank you for coming down. And now I will leave the meeting.
Well, what a day. Don't you just love it when a plan comes together? It's been one of those days today where, you know, I've never seen the venue before. Came here not really knowing what to expect. I've spoken to a few people who've given me some advice. I've gone for it today, but I felt like I needed to. Once I'd seen the venue and seen what the circumstances, the weather especially, was going to be like, I was a little bit worried. I didn't think there was any point in setting a pole. I had the pole with me, I had rigs with me, and I just felt like I had to go for it. I had to set my mark, put some bait in, and be out there waiting for those fish to feed. It was, there's carp bushing everywhere now, so it's packed up, it's incredible. But this is a great venue, some huge bream in here. I actually caught the biggest fish today, 7 pounds, which is it's a massive fish, and such a privilege to be able to catch beautiful fish. I've spotted about 2.5 pints of bait, 2-3/4 pints of baiting, as you know, at the start of the match, at 70 metres. So I've gone a big distance. I've gone quite a bit further than most people, which was my plan, to try and make my own destiny, try and make my own match and be in control of everything. In hindsight, I think that spotting in definitely worked for me. The guy too to my right caught some fish early, but in the end the fish settled on my bait. I think I should have probably spotted in another 2 or 3 spots with 1.25 hours, 1.5 hours to go, and I might have just caught another 2 or 3 fish. The main thing is, I stayed in front, stayed in touch, didn't make any mistakes, and thankfully I won the match. I'm absolutely over the moon.